In this lecture, we are going to understand how locking works in XV6. Please refer to this URL for information about this complete series of lectures on operating systems. So why does XV6 need locking? Note that there are no threads in XV6, right? So the normal reason why multiple pthreads will need a mutex, that reason does not exist in XV6. However, there is still scope for concurrency in XV6. Why is that? You can have a situation where a process P1 has gone into kernel mode. Another process P2 has also gone into kernel mode on a different CPU. And both of them are accessing the same kernel data structures, right? In this case, there is a possibility of concurrent access to data, to shared data. And therefore, you will need to use locks to avoid race conditions when accessing this shared data. Another situation can occur where a process P1 has gone into kernel mode to handle a trap, and then another interrupt has occurred, right? While P1 is in kernel mode, another interrupt has occurred. And now this interrupt handler can also access the same data that the process in kernel mode was accessing earlier, right? So because of this also, you can have unwanted concurrent access to shared data. For these reasons, XV6 code uses spin locks to protect critical sections. So whenever you are accessing a kernel data structure and there is scope for concurrent access, either say from a process in another kernel or for any other reason, if there is scope for concurrent access, then you will use spin locks. And you will hold the lock for as long as you are in the critical section. So XV6 also has a sleeping lock, which is another abstraction built on top of the spin lock, but we are not going to discuss that in this lecture. So in this lecture, we are going to understand how spin locks work in XV6, right? So this is the spin lock structure. There's basically a variable locked that indicates whether the spin lock is held or not. And of course, there is some information for debugging. So how do you acquire a lock in XV6? We have seen in a previous lecture on locking that locks are implemented using hardware atomic instructions. So in XV6 also, this instruction exchange is used, right? So this is very similar to the test and set instruction that we have seen in a previous lecture. So what does this exchange instruction do? It tries to set this locked variable to 1. And returns the previous value, okay? So if you try to set this variable to 1 and the value returned is 0, the previous value is 0, what does that mean? This means that the lock was free earlier. The previous value was 0. You managed to set it to 1. Therefore, you managed to acquire the lock, right? In which case, you succeeded in acquiring the lock. So go ahead and return. On the other hand, if you try to set the value of 1 and the value returned to you is not equal to 0, this means that the lock is still held. Therefore, you have to wait. So you busily spin in a while loop. So this is the code for acquiring a spin lock in XV6. So this is similar to the code that we have seen earlier with respect to acquiring locks using atomic hardware instructions. And the code for releasing the lock, I've not shown it here, but it is simple. It is basically setting this locked variable to 0. Okay. And there is this step of synchronizing here. So this is just to tell the C compiler and the processor not to reorder the loads and stores. So this is related to a optimization in the underlying hardware that we'll not discuss right now. So the other very important thing with respect to spin locks is that you must disable interrupts on the CPU core on which you are acquiring the spin lock. Okay, why is this? Because when a process has acquired, say it has acquired a lock L, you do not want an interrupt to occur and this interrupt handler once again requests this lock L. In which case, what will happen? You will have a deadlock because you can no longer, this interrupt handler is spinning for this lock L. It is a spin lock. It is spinning for the lock L. You cannot go back to the previous code to release the lock, and therefore you are stuck. right? So therefore, you have to disable interrupts on the CPU core on which you have acquired a spin lock to avoid this deadlock. Note that on some other core, you can have another process spinning for the lock. Okay, there could be another process that is spinning for lock L on another CPU core. That is okay. So this is not okay, but this is okay. Why? Because it this process on another core can keep spinning, and this process P will eventually run and release the lock, and then this other process on another core will get it, right? So on one core C1, if you have held a spin lock, on another core C2, it is okay for another process P2 to try to acquire for this lock and spin for it. Okay, because P1 is running on this core, it has the lock, it will release it eventually. But it is not okay for some other interrupt handler core to spin on the same core for this lock, because it will never be released. So therefore, we will have to disable interrupts only on this CPU core. And note that this interrupt disabling has to happen before we start to spin, right? This is the line of code that disable interrupts, and this has to happen before exchange. Why is that? Why don't we, for example, wait for us to acquire the lock and then disable interrupts? Because if you think of disabling interrupts somewhere over here, then you still have a vulnerable window after acquiring the lock and before disabling interrupts, where all of these bad things can happen and interrupt can occur and it can deadlock and so on, which we do not want, right? So therefore, you must disable interrupts before you start spinning for a spin lock. So this is the code that disables interrupts. This is the push CLI function. And note that interrupt should stay disabled as long as the lock is held. So now what if you have multiple spin locks? You have acquired spin lock L1, then you have acquired spin lock L2. Now until both these locks are released, the interrupt should stay disabled, right? So therefore, when you are releasing a lock, you cannot simply re-enable interrupts. You have to check that all locks are released. How do you do it? This push CLI function, it updates a count. And the pop CLI function that is called when you release a lock, this function decrements the count. And only if this count is zero, then you will go ahead and re-enable interrupts, right? We are only re-enabling interrupts only after all spin locks have been released. So in some sense, these push and the pop, they match each other. So now there are many different spin locks in the x86 code protecting many different data structures. The most important one is the P table lock, right? We've seen this process table in x86, which is an array of struct procs of all processes in x86. And this is protected by a lock, the P table dot lock. Okay, so this is a very important lock in x86. And any access to the P table must be done with this lock held. Okay, so anytime a process wants to change the P table, for example, the alloc proc code we have seen earlier wants to allocate a new struct proc for a newly created process. So this will acquire the P table lock, change the P table, and release the lock. Okay, but there is also a special situation in the kernel, which is the context switch. What happens during the context switch from one process to another? This P table structure is changed multiple times. It is changed by P1 to set its state. It is changed later by the scheduler. It is changed by P2. So multiple processes are changing this P table during the entire period of this context switch. So from where to where do you hold the lock? You have to hold the lock throughout this transition. So how do you do that? The way it is done is as follows. So P1 will first acquire the lock, then all the context switch will happen, and finally P2 will release the lock. Okay, this is a special case. Normally, the same process that is running in kernel mode will acquire the lock, do its critical section, and release the lock. But a context switch is a special case where this ptable.lock is held throughout this process, acquired by one process and released by the other process. So now let us understand this ptable.lock and the context switch in a little bit more detail. So what we need is that every function that calls sced, remember that sced is the function invoked by processes to start a context switch to give up the CPU, right? So every function that calls sced will do so with the ptable.log already acquired, okay? This is an invariant. All processes ensure this in the kernel. So where are all the places where sced is called? We've seen this before, right? Yield, when a timer interrupt occurs and a process has run for its time slice, it wants to give up the CPU, it calls sced, and this is the code for yield. You can see that you acquire the ptable log, set your state to runnable, and then call sced. Similarly, if you go back and look, the code for sleep, the code for exit, anytime a process wishes to give up the CPU, either to block or to terminate, in all of these cases also, you will first acquire the ptable log and then you will call sced. So going into the context switch, the ptable.log is always held. Now, you context switch to the scheduler, then you switch back into some other process, the new process that is switched in. Now, where will you start in that new process? Wherever you start that new process, the first thing it will do is it will release the ptable log. So every function that you switch into will release the ptable log, okay? Wherever the switch function will context switch you into will release the ptable log. So where are all the places that you context switch into? For example, if you switched from say a process P1 to a process P2, what are all the places that P2 can start? So P2 can start in yield. If P2 had given up its CPU in the past in yield, it will once again resume back at the same point, and as soon as it resumes, it will release the ptable log. Similarly, you can look at the code for sleep. There also, as soon as the call to sced returns, context switch returns to the same point that it stopped, the switch code returns to the same point, immediately you will release the ptable log. So what is the other third place that switch can return into? That is the fork rate. Now, newly created processes, they don't start in yield or sleep, they start in fork rate. And in fork rate, again, as soon as a newly forked process is context switched in for the first time, it is scheduled in by the scheduler and starts running the code of fork rate, the first thing it will do is release the ptable log. So this is in fact one of the main purposes of fork rate, to release the ptable log. Otherwise, what does a newly created process do? The first thing it will do right after fork rate is you will call trap rate and you will return from trap, right? So why aren't we doing that right away? We are not doing that right away because first you have to release the ptable log and then you will return from trap. So in summary, anytime a process is going into a context switch, it will hold the ptable log, and the process that runs immediately after the context switch will release the ptable log. So now what about the scheduler? So this is once again the scheduler loop that we've seen many times so far. When you are entering the scheduler loop, you will start with this ptable log acquired. Then the scheduler loops over the processes. There's a for loop. It will find a runnable process and it will switch to it. Now the ptable log is held, and whichever process the scheduler, suppose the scheduler switches to some process P1, as soon as P1 starts to run, it will release the ptable log. Then at a later point of time, P1 wants to give up the CPU again. It will acquire the ptable log, come back to this point in the scheduler again. Then the scheduler will go to the next iteration of the for loop. Ptable log is still held. It will find some other process to switch to. And that some other process once again will release the ptable log, and before coming back to the scheduler will once again reacquire the ptable log, and so on. This process keeps on repeating. Okay, so within this loop of the scheduler, the ptable log is always held. Whenever we come back here, we do so with the ptable log held. Now, sometimes the scheduler finishes this loop. At the end of the loop, it releases the ptable log after it has gone through all the processes. Once in a while, it releases the ptable log and goes back to this bigger for loop and reacquires the log again. So periodically, once in a while, the scheduler releases the log for some time and reacquires it later on. Why does it do this? Because whenever the ptable lock is held, all interrupts are disabled. So maybe a lot of processes are blocked for some disk reads or some events like that, and they are not able to run, and you're constantly holding the lock and keeping the interrupts disabled. That is not a good thing. So periodically you will release the lock, wait for any interrupts to occur, wait for processes to become runnable, and repeat this loop again. Okay. So in summary, we've seen how spin locks are implemented in XV6 based on the exchange. This is an x86 hardware atomic instruction equivalent to the test and set. And processes in kernel mode always hold the spin lock when accessing shared kernel data structures, and interrupts are disabled on the core on which the lock is held. And we've also seen some interesting details about the special ptable lock inside the kernel that is held across a context switch. Any process going into a context switch holds the ptable lock, and the process that runs immediately after the context switch completes releases the ptable lock.